If you would, this morning, we're going to continue in our study in the book of Mark, Mark chapter 10. It has been interesting as I've started working through this series. I realized that next Sunday I'm going to be dealing with the triumphal entry. You ought to try that sometime when it's not just before Easter. Normally, that's what we deal with going into Easter. So I worked hard for next Sunday's sermon, trying to get a sermon that wasn't just moving right into Easter. And God has shown me some things. I'll tell you what that'll make you do. It'll make you study more. And it'll make you see that there's more than one message out of every passage of Scripture. And that's what I found out as I was preparing for that. But we're in the part today leading up to the triumphal entry. You know, Jerry and I were watching. I've heard several people say that you've seen the new television show, Scorpion. It's a neat show. It is about these young geniuses, literally geniuses, IQ off the scale, and they are brought in. They were doing things with the genius stuff they probably shouldn't have been doing, but they are now working for the government, and they're being brought in to save the day when disasters take place and disasters are unfolding. In the pilot of that movie, as they were starting, first found out, and all this is taking place, there is a virus that had hit LAX airport and messed up the systems so that all the radar systems and all the communication systems with the planes were down for LAX and the neighboring airport where people would be landing. And there were literally 50 planes circling, waiting to land, and without that communication, these planes were going to run out of fuel and, of course, crash. And then there was concern, well, if they start trying to land without radio communications, it could be just a disaster. So the team is working on trying to figure out how to fix that. Well, as they decide what the fix is going to be, and we can do this, but time won't allow to land two of the planes. We can't get this done, and there's two planes that will not be able to land. And evidently, protocol was for these planes to, once they couldn't land, was to go out over the ocean. And what the plan was the jet fighters would come in, and they would do their job, and of course take those two planes down, and everyone that was on those planes would be lost, but it would save everyone else. As they were describing that, there's this one girl that is in the movie or in the show that is like us, normal. She has emotions. She has the geniuses did not work off of emotions. It was all brain stuff. But this one girl looks and she says, well, but that means everyone on these two planes will perish. The government official that was standing there said, well, yeah, but that's a reasonable loss because we can lose these two planes full of people, but we'll save everyone else. So you just have to understand that. And she looks at the head genius and she makes the statement, losing even one is not acceptable. Figure something out. And you know what he did? And they saved the day and everyone landed safely and all of that stuff. But I got to thinking about that, and I was looking at this passage of Scripture. Jesus is on with his disciples headed toward Jerusalem, and then out of a crowd, a cry comes. One cry that was heard. And as we think about that, so often we think of Jesus and what he does for the masses. And Jesus in the world, he died for the world. But you know what? It comes down to one. It comes down to that personal thing, that one person. And that's what we're going to see today. Would you stand with me as we read Mark chapter 10, beginning with verse 46. They came to Jericho, and as he was leaving Jericho with his disciples, a large crowd, Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, a blind beggar, was sitting by the road. When he heard that it was Jesus the Nazarene, he began to cry out, Son of David, Jesus, have mercy on me. Many people told him to keep quiet, But he was crying out all the more, "Have mercy on me, son of David." Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." So they called the blind man and said to him, "Have courage, get up, he's calling for you." He threw off his coat, jumped up, and came to Jesus. Then Jesus answered him, "What do you want me to do for you?" "Rabboni," the blind man told him, "I want to see." "Go your way," Jesus told him, "your faith has healed you." Immediately he could see and began to follow him on the road. Lord God, we thank you for your word. And Lord, although physically we're not sitting on the side of the road today, we all have needs. And at some point in our lives, we've all found ourselves like this man. So Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit who is here will take your word, apply it to our lives, and then we will respond to you. Thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We start off by finding one in need. Jesus' movement is at a quick pace. He has a deadline to meet. He has an appointment to make. His face is set. His mind is focused. He's on his way to Jerusalem for what we call the triumphal entry, but we know that's just the beginning of the events that will be taking place as Jesus comes into the city and he's going to be arrested. He's going to be beaten. He's going to be tortured. He's going to be crucified. And so with all of that, he knows what's coming, and he is more than willing to do that. He's more than willing to put himself into that place and do what he was born to do. He knows that's his purpose. That's his reason for being on earth, and what a great assignment it is. Not only does the future of one nation, Israel, hang in the balance, if Jesus doesn't follow through, if he doesn't do what his purpose is, then the nation is in trouble. But folks, I want you to see that it's more than just the nation of Israel. If Jesus doesn't make this appointment, all mankind hangs in the balance. Jesus must make this appointment because the future of the world depends on it. As you and I sit here today, our lives, our eternity depends on Jesus making that appointment. And so he's on his way. It's preset. Nothing can stop him. He's traveling with his 12 disciples, as the Bible says, as well as a large group of people. But we need to understand that the road he's traveling down is the road that's going into Jerusalem. People are heading there for Passover. And so there's a large group of people traveling that road too. It's not just Jesus and a few people walking down a deserted road. This road is filled with pilgrims headed toward Jerusalem for Passover. So you can imagine the noise. You can imagine the dust being stirred up just from that many people and that much foot traffic. And out of all that hustle and bustle comes a cry. One cry above all the others. One beggar, probably one beggar out of many beggars that lined the roads at that time, hoping to get a little bit of something. But this one beggar catches the ear of Jesus. Out of all the noise, out of all the talking, all the animals that would have been along in the process, something about Bartimaeus, the blind man, caught Jesus' attention. I think it's well worth our energy to stop and say, well, what is it? What is it about one cry out of all the others that could catch the attention of Jesus? Because I tell you, I want to know. What do I need? What is it that I could call out that would catch the attention of Christ? And I think the first thing that I see is it's in what he said. Son of David, have mercy on me. Have mercy on me, son of David. Well, in that title, what we see is an acknowledgement of who Jesus is. He is acknowledging Jesus as the Messiah, the promised one, the one that will set up a kingdom, the one that will be the king of the Jews, the one that has been promised, the one that has been prophesied, son of David, the rightful heir to the throne of David. When we acknowledge Christ for who he is, we get his attention. There's a lot of people that talk about Jesus. There's a lot of people that have an idea about who Jesus is, and they talk about it, well, he's a great teacher, he's this or he's that, but in this title, Bartimaeus has caught the point of who Jesus was. And when he calls out, when he makes that statement, Jesus turns. It wasn't just another voice in the crowd anymore. It was a personal call to the person of Christ. But not only did he acknowledge Jesus for who he was, he admitted his need. And you say, well, we hadn't gotten to that part. He admitted his need in this very opening statement. Son of David, have mercy on me. When we ask that, when he asked that, we are saying we have a need that we cannot meet. But what we're also saying is, God, I don't deserve it. By asking for God's mercy, we're saying mercy is God not giving us what we deserve. And so this man says, Son of David, don't give me what I deserve. Have mercy on me. Well, what did he deserve? The exact same thing you and I deserve. Death. Not healing, not salvation, not anything from Jesus. We deserve nothing. That's why he called out for mercy. He could have called out for grace. And we're going to see as we go through this that he got grace. But he called out for mercy. Jesus, don't give me what I deserve. Think about it. Jesus didn't owe him anything. He could have just kept right on walking. As a matter of fact, What if I miss this appointment down here? What if I miss this appointment? If I'm Jesus and I miss this appointment that's going to bring salvation to the world, this is just one guy. Just one. Am I going to take the chance of missing that assignment I have for one man? Jesus made a choice to stop. And this shows us the personal compassion of Christ. Who, although he knew what was before him, he knew how tragic it was going to be, he knew how big it was going to be and what it would accomplish, but yet he had time for one. Not one of riches, not one of wealth, but one blind beggar. Insignificant to most of the world. And Jesus had time for him. This man caught his attention. Lord, I can't do it for myself, but just don't give me what I deserve. One person in need of help. But the other thing I see here is there's only one who could help. Only one who could help. My guess is this guy had seen the doctors. He had the family members trying to help. He had had advice from every corner, but here was one that could help. Think about the scene. Jesus not only heard him, but he stopped and he responded to him. Aren't you thankful he stops for us? Aren't you thankful he stops and he takes time and he has time for us and he responds to us? He doesn't just ignore us. Look at verse 49. Jesus stopped and said, call him. He stopped and said, call him. Now, I studied this verse for quite a while and I was intrigued about something that not a commentary I could find addressed. And that really made me want to dig into it a little deeper. Jesus was mobile. In other words, he had 2 feet that worked very well. He could see where he was going. He could see the road ahead of him. He could see all the people around him. He could see the pothole in the road. He could see anything that had been dropped that might trip him up. He had all of his faculties about him. Am I the only one that wonders why a guy like Jesus, with all his faculties about him, would look at a blind guy and say, hey, come over here. This guy couldn't see where he was going. Wouldn't it have been just as easy for Jesus to walk over here to where he was? But for some reason, Jesus called him to come to him. Now, on the surface, it sounds a little cruel. Let's watch the blind guy stumble around a little bit here, you know? I mean, never mind. Why would you call a blind man to come to you when he can't see and you can't? Well, as I started thinking about that, the first thing that hit me is it's kind of Jesus' method of operation. It's his M.O. It's what he does. Go back through Scripture and look, it's his practice. He called the disciples out. He had conversations with them, but he tended to just walk by and say, follow me. And they had to get up from what they were doing and follow. They couldn't just sit there. When he called when the woman who came to him and touched his garment in the crowd and then disappeared back into the crowd, Jesus just didn't go to her and say, hey, I know you touched me, because you know he knew. No, he stood where he was and he said, who touched me? And he called her out of the crowd. In Matthew 11:28, he says, come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. There's something about Jesus, the way he operates, is he calls us to come to him. He issues a call. You say, well why? What is it about that? I think it has something to do with commitment. You really want what I've got to offer? Come to me. I'm not just going to sit there and dump it in your lap. You got to come to me. You got to have some motivation. Now, there are a lot of people looking for handouts in the world today. And I believe there were a lot of people in Jesus' day looking for things. What can you give me? This man is amazing because he's already admitted he doesn't deserve anything, which is totally backwards from what most people think today. But now Jesus says, okay, I know you don't deserve anything, but get up, blind man, and come to me. See, it's the same call, no matter what your condition. Come to me. You might say, yeah, but Jesus, he had already acknowledged who Jesus was. Well, okay, but we can say that, but I've looked, and as I look at Scripture, I mean, the demons that possessed the man in the cemetery, who was cutting himself, the wild man, the crazy man, the guy that was naked and kept ripping his clothes and he was chained, the demons recognized Jesus and called him who he was. There was no doubt in their mind who he was. So just acknowledging who he is isn't enough. Christ wants us to come out of the crowd, to walk away from the security of the crowd. You know, it's kind of like going to a setting in a classroom you have those few that come up and sit on the front, and I'm not picking on front row people today, okay? I love you being here. But I'm talking about in a classroom setting. I mean, you got the brains that come and sit on the front row. I guess you'd like for me to talk to you about like that. Okay, they sit on the front row, and they're the ones that are always answering the questions. They're the people that mess up the curve on the test. And then you got the ones that really don't want to be in there anyway. Hello, Matt. Yeah, you know, they sit on the back row. And then for most of us, we like to filter in the middle, because you figure if he's going to pick on somebody, it's going to be the front row or the back row. And maybe I can be in the center and kind of blend in the crowd and nobody will notice. And no one will think anything. They won't call me out. But isn't it just like Jesus? Whether you're in the middle, the front, or the back, he says, come on, you got to come to me. You got to come out of the crowd. You've got to come out of that comfort. You can't be hiding in the crowd. You got to come out. Come to me. It requires you leaving where you are. It requires effort. It requires commitment to get up and to come out of the crowd to Christ. But another picture I see here with this blind man is that Jesus didn't give him vision and then say, now that you can see, come on. He didn't say, you're healed, now come to me. No, he said, come the way you are. Bring your blindness to me. Come out and bring your blindness with you and come to me. This man had to make a walk of faith, not a walk of sight. Now, if you're in the middle of the crowd and Jesus heals you and he gives you sight, then you're going to get up and run for him. You're going to come out. You're excited. But this guy hadn't been healed yet. Jesus called him to himself before any healing had taken place. Whether you're blind physically or you're blind spiritually, it takes faith on your part to come to Christ. Now, there's always that discussion of, is it all God? Is it all man? God, you know, let's not get bogged down in too much stuff here. Jesus is the initiator. I mean, Jesus chose to go down that road. He knew the man was going to be there. But he called for the faith of the man to be demonstrated by coming to him when Jesus called him out. The blind beggar demonstrates for us how we are to come to Christ by faith, not by sight, by faith. Verse 50, we see, he threw off his coat and he jumped up and came to Jesus. Now, we wouldn't think too much of that. Let me tell you, every beggar didn't have a coat. That would have been a prized possession for him, the luxury of having a coat. Not only would it keep him warm when he needed to be warm, but it could also be a pallet for him to sit on. He spent a lot of hours on the side of that road. It could have been a clean pallet to sit on. It could have been rolled up into a pillow to lay his head on. This was something that most of the beggars would not have had. So Jesus was asking him to leave what he had and come to him. But I want to show you something else. That coat was probably a long coat. Now, I don't know about you, but I can trip over my own feet real easy. Can you imagine being blind and having a long coat? And you start rushing? You start moving quickly? What do you think is going to happen? You could easily be tripped up. We watch that all the time as we have weddings in here. And you know, if we're doing the rehearsals and we're talking to the bride and groom, one of the things that I caution the grooms on, dude, you have no trouble walking. You can see your feet. She can't see hers. Be careful as you're coming up the steps. Go slow. If you have to, help her lift her dress. Do whatever it takes to keep her from falling out here in front of everybody, because she'll never forgive you or me, either one. And then once you get up here and the ceremony's over, move slow going down. Don't let her trip and fall. You'll never hear the end of it. That long coat could have tripped this man up. And so he threw it off. I want you to take and contrast that with the man we talked about last week, I believe it was. The man that came to Jesus and said, how do I inherit eternal life? And Jesus told him, what? Go and sell all that you have, because he was rich. And then follow me. Then you'll have eternal life. And the Bible says a man went away sad, disappointed, because he had a lot. In other words, he wasn't willing to let go of it. Well, here's a man that doesn't have much, who's willing to give up what little he has, that one luxury that he has, a coat. He's willing to give it up, because there's something that's worth more. And because he doesn't want anything to slow him down from getting to the one that can bring him and give him what he wants. I love the way one theologian put it. He said, with rare abandon, he made absolutely sure that the hindrance was removed before it had a chance to do damage. I ask you this morning, what are you hanging on to? What is that thing that's keeping you from in abandon coming to Christ? In abandon being called out of the crowd? In abandon getting up, blind as you may be, and coming to Christ? What are you holding on to? What a beautiful picture of this man who had so little, yet gave it up. Left it by the side of the road to come to Christ. And then Jesus did something that, again, was real strange. He looked at him and he said, what do you want me to do for you? Now that's one of those duh moments, you know? I mean, what did you think he was going to tell you, Jesus? You know his problem. But he wanted to hear it from him. What do you want me to do for you? And when the reply came, there was nothing ambiguous about it. Master. The Bible says Rabboni. That's bigger than rabbi. It's master teacher, respected teacher. I want to see. He had already acknowledged him as Jesus, the Messiah. Master teacher, respected teacher, I want to see. When you're blind, what greater thing would there be than sight? Tells me I need to quit being bashful about my needs when I come to Christ. Sometimes people say, well, we need to tell people what we need to share with each other, and I agree with this, what Jesus is doing in our lives. The problem is we're so general in our requests that if he does answer, we're not real sure what he answered. Folks, if you can't see, tell him, I want to see. Whatever that need is, express that need to Christ. So that when he does answer, you can give him the glory. You can respond appropriately. So you know that answer to prayer. And that happens whether it's an individual or whether it's a church. Sometimes our prayers are so general that we can't really tell you an answer to prayer because it was just, Lord, bless us. Let me tell you, this guy wasn't asking for a general blessing. He was saying, I can't see. I don't deserve what you have, but I want to see. If you go back into Isaiah, you see some prophecies. And what we're about to see here is prophecies fulfilled. Isaiah 29:18. On that day, the deaf will hear the words of a document, and out of the deep darkness, the eyes of the blind will see. Isaiah 32:3. When the eyes of those who see will not be closed, and the ears of those who hear will not listen. In Isaiah 35:5, when the eyes of the blind will be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. What we see here is prophecy about to be fulfilled. I need to see. Look what takes place. Jesus says, go your way. Your faith has healed you. And then the Bible says immediately he could see. The word translated healed is a word that means to save, to make whole, to deliver, to preserve from danger, to preserve from loss, to preserve from destruction. And so two things happened here. The guy calls for mercy. Jesus, Messiah, God the Son, have mercy on me. And so what we see is God's mercy delivered. He doesn't give the man what he deserves. He doesn't give him death. He doesn't leave him in a blind state, spiritually or physically. And now we see God's grace. God not only delivers the mercy that he was asking him for, of not giving him what he deserves, but God now delivers his grace because he says, dude, I know you don't deserve it. I know you don't deserve eternal life. I know you don't deserve spiritual sight. But he heals him. He heals him spiritually. So when it says, Your faith has healed you. That is a reference to what took place inside the man. He is now a child of God. He's now healed him from his sin. He's now taken that sin away. He's whole internally. And so we have God delivering his mercy, which is not delivering the judgment. And then God delivering his grace, which is giving the man eternal life. And isn't it just like Jesus just to toss the cherry on top of the thing and give him physical sight too? I mean, think about it. Of the whole story, he was asking to see. And Jesus says, I'm going to help you see. I'm going to give you sight so that you have spiritual sight. You have eternal life. And by the way, now you can see physically too. Now, it doesn't always happen that way. He doesn't always heal us of our infirmities. And there's no silver bullet for that. There's no rabbit's foot for that. There's no guarantee for that. Because let me tell you, I think when the man got up and came, he had faith in Christ. Not that he would, but that he could. That he may. Several times in Scripture, we see people coming with their request to Christ, and they say, if you would. If you would, you may. And the Bible gives us an instance where you're almost reading their mind and thinking, if we can get to him, he may see fit to do this. See, that's faith. Coming to him, knowing that he can, praying that he will, and knowing that he might. And this guy gets there, and Jesus gives him more than he could ever imagine. Spiritual life, eternal life. Not the death that he deserved. Physical sight, so now he can see. God's mercy plus God's grace plus your faith in Christ equals eternal life, healing, and sight. What a beautiful picture. How fitting the songs were that we sang this morning as we move toward this. Glorious one. No one else could have done it. He could have called out to anybody else on that road, and no one else could have delivered what he just had delivered to him. And folks, he's still offering it to us. It didn't end on that day. It extends all through history, and it is still available to you and to me today. And there's only one. We're one person out of many with needs. And there is one who can meet our biggest need, starting internally, starting in our hearts, starting in our souls. And then he has the power to meet our external needs. Now, this is a glorious event, and we could stop the sermon right here, but I still got a few minutes. And if we stopped it here, it'd be incomplete. Because you remember I told you that when we started moving into verse 10, or chapter 10, and you know the first Sunday that we were back in, it was dealing with divorce and marriage and possessions the next week and so forth. And you remember I told you it was about the disciple and his life? How to live the disciple's life? Well, see, if we stop right here, we miss that here in this story. Notice in verse 52, Jesus told the man, go your way. Notice what the healed, saved man did. The Bible says he began to follow him, being Jesus, on the road. Now, we don't know what the situation was with Bartimaeus. We know he was blind. But we don't know if he was blind from birth or if he had become blind later in life. We don't have any idea on that. And it really doesn't matter. What we're sure of is that he hadn't been able to see. And can you imagine what had been going through his mind? What have I missed? Can you imagine day after day and night after night thinking, man, if something were to happen that I could see, I would see the birds, and I could stand and watch the waves that I've only heard rolling in from the sea. I'd be able to see the golden fields that I've never seen or I haven't seen in a long time, those that are ready for harvest. I'd see the beautiful mountains and the plush valleys. There are so many places I'd like to go, so many things I'd like to see. Don't you know, he was thinking, man, I wish I could see my dad's face. I wish I could see my mom's face. If he was married and had a family, I wish I could just see my wife's face, my children's face. All those people that I've had contact with from birth on up, all those that I've wanted to see them, and if I could just see, can you imagine his dreams? Can you imagine his desires? Now he can see. But if you look at the text here, and there's a word play here. The Greek word that's used for road is a word that is translated way, W-A-Y. So it's interesting. Jesus says, go your way. And then the Bible says, let's look back at it again. Jesus says, go your way. Your faith has healed you. And immediately he could see and begin to follow him on the road. Let's use that word way there. Immediately he could see and began to follow him on the way. You see what just happened here? Everything that man had dreamed about, everything that it meant to him up till that point of going your way to go see all these things he hadn't seen before, suddenly his way changed. Suddenly his way wasn't what he had dreamed of all these years. Suddenly now he's been saved by the only one that could help him. He's only got one thing he can do. One move is appropriate here. One action is the right action. By his action, he is saying, Lord, your way is now my way. Lord, there is but one way, and that's wherever you're going. Lord, I'm following you. Now, folks, that's true discipleship. Listen, when people think and say that they've been saved and they don't follow Christ, they haven't been saved. Because for a disciple of Christ, for a follower of Christ, to accept salvation and then say, I'm going off to do something else, that's not right with Scripture. Your way changes. Your desire changes. There's something inside of you that says, how can I dare go any other way except his way? Because he is the only one that could bring eternal life. He is the only one that could do for me what I needed done for myself, and I couldn't do it. Nobody else can do it. Who else would I follow but him? It's a picture of a disciple. One that has been so radically changed by God. And you say, yeah, but I'm not like this guy. I wasn't sitting on the side of the road blind. I could see. Spiritually, we all were blind and headed for one place, and that was destruction and hell. And when Jesus touches our life, we can now see, and our direction changes, and we're going to follow him. Now, there's a lot of us that are struggling to figure out exactly how to do that. And we'd love to help you with it, because I think he works primarily in the New Testament through his church. And so part of following him is being part of a local body so that you work together for the cause of Christ. But folks, it's about following Christ. And it's not just enough to say a prayer, to ask him into our lives, to be dunked in a pool, and then go on with our life. No, it's that growth process that takes place as we continue to follow him. As we learn more about him. And see, salvation, the Bible talks of it as past tense, present tense, and future tense. I was saved. This man was saved on this road. But he was being saved as he followed Christ. And he will be saved when he died and ended up in eternity with Christ. So for us, There is a time that I come to faith in Christ, a point in time when my spiritual blindness is gone and I can see. That's a day of my salvation. And from then on, as I walk this earth, I am being saved. In other words, I am being transformed into the likeness of Christ. And let me tell you, you got to get up from where you are and follow Him to have that happen in your life. If you don't, you're living a lie. Follow Him, and then one day you'll be saved to all eternity. A picture of a disciple. One person with a need that he couldn't meet and no one else could meet. One person lost who met the one person that could change his life for all eternity. And then he went the only way he could go, and that was to follow Christ. Folks, this morning, if you don't know Christ as your personal Savior, we want to invite you to come to faith in Him. You say, well, I can't see Him. None of us have. But I'm more sure that Jesus is who He says He is than I've ever been before. He is salvation. He is one that loves you more than anyone else. He died for you. Will you come to Him today? In just a moment, Josh is going to be here and I'll be here, and we're waiting for you. We'd love to share with you how you can have that personal relationship with Jesus Christ. How you can start that journey of discipleship following Christ. Maybe there's some of you here that have already made that decision. You've accepted Christ, but you've never followed Him in believer's baptism. That's the first step of being a disciple. He says, you identify with me through that. It's that picture of what's taken place inside of your life, that transformation. Maybe you've already done that and you've never joined with a local church, and God's brought you here, and this is where you're being fed. This is where you're beginning to fit in, and would you come join with us? And continue to grow as a disciple following Christ? Maybe you're here today and you've got some struggle in your life. And you need to just kneel here at this altar by yourself or with someone else. We'd be happy to pray with you. Others around would. And just say, Lord, I want to tell you what I want. I want to tell you what I need. Don't deserve it, but I just want to tell you what my need is. And you just, on your knees, tell Him, this is my need. And God, I'm coming to You in faith that You can do it and that You might do it. But I have faith that You'll do what's best. The altar will be open.